The proviso being, we did not necessarily Hi, how are you, my friend? So good to see you. Oh, my pleasure.
Okay, I know it's fun for everybody to catch up, but let's take our seats and move on to the next program. So I am Richard Griffiths. I'm the President Emeritus of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, and delighted on behalf of the foundation that you're all here today. I'm really, really excited about our next panel. Usually it is the journalists who are asking the questions, as you saw with Bill Nygut grilling the panel just now. Instead, we have three journalists about to be interrogated by a retired federal judge on media coverage of the courts. Bill Duffey, to my right, recently retired as a district judge for the Northern District of Georgia, an appointee of George W. Bush. He served 14 years in the courthouse just up the street. While he was there, he dealt with quite some high-profile cases, including some terrorism cases. Before his judicial appointment, he served as U.S. Attorney for the Northern District, and he also worked for Ken Starr in handling the Arkansas end of the Whitewater investigation. So in court and his other roles, Bill has had plenty of exposure to media scrutiny. And despite him being a dear friend and a cycling buddy, I have never been able to convince him of the value of cameras in the courtroom. So perhaps one day he will see the light. Not likely today, I think, in this case. Anyway, so I'd like to invite Bill Duffey to take it away. Thank you very much for doing this.
I'm looking forward to being able to ask these questions. We're going to try to do a couple things today, and it comes, I think, principally from our collective interest, and certainly my personal interest, is what is, having been on the other side of media answering questions for them, I'm not sure anymore what the media is. I'm not sure anymore what journalism is. And certainly from somebody that's been a public official and a court official, I'm not sure the people that cover us, what their motivations are, because I've read a lot of their reporting, and it seems to be reflective often of their political ideologies. So we're going to start, though, with these three experts telling us from their perspective what is a journalist, and what is journalism today? The second thing we're going to do is talk about where we ended up with this, with the last group, which is, what is the reputation of the judiciary in the eyes of the public today? I personally think it is poor. It's poor, and my sources are the people that I'm closest to that talk about the judiciary today, in ways that they did not talk about the judiciary 10 years ago. And the question is, why is that? There has been a lot of press criticism that that comes from public comments, as we just heard, by high-level government officials, including presidents, and not just one, criticizing the judiciary and its decision-making, and more recently, criticizing individuals within particular cases. I think certainly that is something that affects the public's view of the judiciary, but I also think the journalists and the press bear some burden and responsibility for the way that the public perceives the judiciary today. We're going to get into that in the second point. And then finally, I've promised these three journalists, two of whom have covered me for a long time, Mark I have not known as well or as long. But now that I am completely liberated from all of the oppressive restrictions that I've had for a long time, I told them that since I'm such a rare commodity that I could actually be honest about what in response to a question because I don't have the restrictions I used to have, that they may each ask me one question. And assuming it's appropriate, I'll answer it, and I'll answer it candidly, because I've thought a lot about what it was like to be a judge and what it was like to be a public official. And so that's my compensation to them for being on the panel. You'll be interested to know that each of them wanted to know what I wanted to be asked. And I said, that really doesn't accomplish what I want to accomplish. Because first of all, I want to know what they want to know. I don't want them to ask me what I want to know. So with that, let's jump into this idea of what do you do, how do you do it, and how do you evaluate that, and what pressures you have on you. What is journalism? And there are some common definitions. I went to the most common, I think, that we have, and that's Merriam-Webster. A person is engaged in journalism, especially a writer or editor for a news medium, and a writer who aims at a mass audience. So that's a generic, accepted, colloquial definition of journalist. The question is, are you a journalist, Robin? And if so, what is your market?
I'm a journalist. Actually, I've been a journalist since I published my first newspaper in the third grade. My market is specialized. It's you all. It's lawyers and judges in particular. We do hope to pull in broader audiences who are interested in the law and legal issues, but our audience primarily is directed at lawyers and judges.
Bill, what's yours? I mean, you also reported and cover the courts, and is your market different than Robin's, since she's described basically what I think you did?
Yeah, we focus on the metro area primarily, but if there are cases that resonate throughout, you know, in the far corners of the state that could have the emblematic of a problem or a issue, we report on those as well. I have a podcast called Breakdown. It's my editor got this program where he could call up a map of the world and see at that moment who was listening, which was kind of cool. And London, Chicago, New York, Toronto, Sydney, Hong Kong. And I told him I wasn't going to let me have that because I would have been looking at it all the time. But so it depends, you know, international and, but we try to get the local market here.
Now, Mark, you're a little different. You're up in D.C. Is it not just focused on the local courts. Just briefly describe what you do and what your market is.
So I cover the Supreme Court for the Associated Press, and our audience is essentially worldwide. And I can write a story when my kids were young, and we would go on vacation. It used to be great when we'd get to some news box in front of the hotel and there'd be a story with dad's byline on the front page, and they always got a kick out of that. I guess I did too. But I've been a journalist for more than 30 years and worked for many of them in the building right next door with these guys, as well as some other people in the audience. I don't know if I could jump ahead and say, you asked what a journalist is.
Yes.
Well, I think we are all journalists by virtue of our jobs and the reputations we've developed over the years. And I think what's become complicated is that there are people with the rise of the internet and social media who have sort of figured out the way to avoid the sort of filter that we provide when we write our stories. And in their ability to go around traditional journalism, they have figured out a new model, which I'm not sure is necessarily more enlightening, but it certainly provides a much broader range of political viewpoints to what is essentially news reporting.
Well, that's an interesting comment about these. You talked about they don't have to go, they don't have the filters that you have. And then you said that they can express what they express through different political viewpoints. First, do you think people that try to provide information to the public through this non-traditional method are journalists in the sense that they are providing value to the people that are receiving their content?
Well, I mean, I would just say that, sure, I mean, we're not a profession with licenses or anything like that. So, I mean, one can call oneself a journalist, and that's fine. And in many cases, there is value provided. But I do think people need to be able to distinguish the source of the news that's coming at them. And you need to be able to distinguish and discern the difference between what you might read from the AP, what you might hear on MSNBC, and what you might hear on Fox. And those are three very different depictions of the news.
Robin's going to blow up if I don't ask you.
I think Mark is right. I think journalism has become right now more fungible. We have a lot of people because of the internet who have been able to just jump on and write, cover what they want. What is different, I think, is that those of us who are considered traditional journalists or mainstream journalists have tradition and training that we began when we moved into journalism, that a lot of people who are just on the internet writing what they want to write may not have. I mean, we don't have licenses. I would never argue for that. But I think that makes a real difference. And social media, unlike traditional television media and the print media, don't have the same sort of legal standards, are not as bound or tied by libel litigation that we are. So in a lot of ways, we're competing with people, and particularly social media, which claims they are not a publisher, but for example, I really think Facebook is probably the biggest publisher in the world, as is Google. But they do not have to meet the same legal standards that those of us who are in print and traditional television media do. And that creates problems for us in terms of competition, but it also creates problems in terms of presenting factual information as opposed to unchecked information.
Why do you say that somebody who, under their own name, publishes content and tries to provide information to the public is not as subject to slander and libel laws as you are?
The laws involving social media at this point, it's more like the Wild West. And on a social media platform, particularly what they are calling the platforms, the Facebook, Google, Twitter, are not because of, I believe it's the 1996 electronics communication law. They are not bound by the same libel precedents that we are.
So it's your view that if somebody has their own blog that's served by WordPress, and they every day publish articles about their interpretation of events, and they slander or libel somebody, that they're not subject to being sued?
I think it's more difficult because of the nature of the platform, and that the laws that bind, the laws that apply to traditional media, it hasn't caught up with social media.
Mark, what's your view on that?
I'm not sure about the legal liability for something like that, but I mean, I think what is true that we apply a different set of standards. I mean, we we all publish stories in which we don't always get it right, we don't always get the balance right, but we try to provide balanced stories, you know, and we hear from a lot of people on both sides when we, you know, mess up. So I'm not so much speaking to liability, but there is just we have an expectation that what we write is going to withstand scrutiny and criticism. And that's all part of the game as we have sort of known it and played it for many years.
Bill,
I would just say it's more difficult these days because you got to do so much faster. You know, you used to have a deadline when I came here. We'd have a 10:30 deadline for the afternoon newspaper, and then the next deadline could go to 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock. Now, in a big story, you want to be out there as fast as you can. So you got to be. You got to be careful.
You said two really interesting things. One is, I think we all know that if you've lived here for a while, that the AJC had some financial difficulties at time, probably still continues to have financial pressures. And you're trying to, I think the newspaper is trying to do a good job of revisiting how they report and what they report. But the thing that I've heard not from a number of journalists is this, that because there is so much real-time communication of information, often through pictures and press and on-time, at real-time press reports, real-time press reports, that there's this incredible pressure. And secondly, there's this incredible pressure because you are, in fact, competing against blogs, people posting on social media, because there have been some stories that are first released outside the traditional mainstream press. And Robin, you said that you want to write the stories that you write. But you're not just writing the stories that you want to write, you're writing stories that advance and support the financial viability of your organizations. So isn't some of your selection of cases predicated upon whether or not it is going to increase readership?
More so now. It used to be that overall print media was driven largely by circulation. Circulation really didn't filter down to individual journalists and what we wrote and what we covered. Now, with metrics, numbers that they can measure, page views and visitors, yes, we are much more driven by numbers, who reads a story, how long they spend with it. The corollary to that that's a problem for me is that it gives people who read online an enormous an outsized influence on what we cover, because we still have print edition, the AJC still does, there's still a lot of print in the country, but what we are being measured by is who's reading us online. And I think we do make selections more and more now on how many people read a story. So if I'm covering a particular issue and suddenly the numbers drop dramatically, my editor may say, okay, we're not going to cover that case anymore.
Marcus, do you have the same thing happen with your organization? Do you look at what the public wants because your lifeblood is advertising?
Well, the AP's lifeblood isn't advertising, so we don't have that dilemma, but we are very much increasingly driven by metrics. Even as Robin said, how long someone stays with a story, how far down they scroll into the story. It's called dwell time, and you get even numbers on that some days. So it's definitely metrics driven, but no one has ever told me, you know, don't pursue this story because it's going to look bad for somebody else. I mean, sometimes a story idea will get rejected because I just don't think that's an interesting story, and that's the daily interchange between editors and reporters. I do want to say one other thing, which is that right here in Atlanta, you know, more than 30 years ago, there was one of the reasons why Bill Kovach, you know, left the Atlanta Constitution wasn't the only reason, but it had to do with the fact that Atlanta's business community was upset with how aggressively he wanted to pursue stories about business and not positive stories about business in Atlanta. And that, you know, he was not defended by the management of the newspaper. So this is that story that you asked about has gone on for a long time. That's not new. I don't think that's necessarily a product of this new age.
Bill, to what extent do you, when you go and present a story, or your editors have stories, so have to determine what stories are going to be selected, how much do you feel is the analysis based upon readership and whether, even if you think it's an immensely interesting and important story, that would your newspaper say yes, but we don't think it will be viewed, and therefore we don't think we're going to get a lot of people to read it?
I'd say that's very rare. I can't even think of an instance right now. I mean, I've been thinking about that. But Robin and Mark say are right. I mean, we know how many people download stories on the internet. We get the numbers. And I guess maybe the answer is, what stories would you write, not which stories would you not write? You know, what stories are getting the most viewership? But those would also be stories that people, you know, are interested in, which you would want to write about. I guess that's the only answer.
Are you saying that there are other things you think are worthwhile and should be written about, but you don't have the bandwidth, the time, or?
No, we have investigative, we have a whole section of investigative reporters who write stories periodically, not, you know, every week, but so they put a lot of work into it. And I don't necessarily think these stories get a lot of, they get a good number of views, page views, but not like Georgia hiring a football coach or something like that. But we're still going to do those stories. We're still going to do it.
It's not so much whether they're going to hire one, it's how much
they're going to pay him, you know, $5 million. Right.
$5 million would be low, I think.
Right. Yeah.
Let's switch for a second and talk about how your reporting is perceived. For example, in the earlier panel this morning, there is a statement made by one of the panelists, and since that was a media event, I'm going to take that as a press reporting on what they believe on certain events in the state. But there was a comment made about the current president having, and it was said in such a way that it was going to have a disproportionate lasting impact and legacy on the courts. So one, there was no factual information provided for that, but for some reason I had this in my folder. If you look at the last four presidents, President Clinton appointed 62 courts of appeals judges, President Bush appointed 61, President Obama 49, and President Trump 50. For all district court and court of appeals, President Clinton appointed 387, President Bush 340, President Obama 334, and President Trump now 190. These are current as of a month ago. Why don't we provide as much factual content when we hear statements like that, like these sorts of statistics, to let people have context for expressions about and of opinions such as legacy by one or more presidents?
I couldn't agree more that the context is important. I mean, obviously, you're talking about over 4 or 8 years as compared with Trump's appointments to date. So that's one additional piece of context. Other than that, well, that's just a fact. I mean, that's not a
well. We could go to Jimmy Carter's and show you that he's on the line too.
But so. the other thing that's changed, obviously, is that it began to change in the Obama years. The elimination of the filibuster to prevent the confirmation of federal judges, which has now been extended to the Supreme Court. So what prevented the confirmation of a lot more judges in the Obama years and in the Bush years before that was when the Senate was controlled by the opposite party. And there was a virtual shutdown in the final 2 years of the Bush administration and in the final 2 years of the Obama administration. That's not been the case with Trump. The other point there, of course, is that Trump has filled a lot of vacancies that pre-existed his administration, which were held open by virtue of the practice I was just discussing.
Federal Appeals Court in Atlanta?
Yeah.
He did.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, I think he's put 10 judges on the Ninth Circuit out west. He hasn't quite flipped that court, but it's much closer. I mean, it's no longer the sort of liberal bastion that it has been for many years.
Six of the 12 appeals court judges here in Atlanta. Pretty extraordinary.
Well, the same thing has happened on the district court. It used to be a majority Obama appointed court, and now it's more even. This, though, goes to the fundamental question, which is where you are on these close deadlines, have to produce content, have to do it quickly. Are we depriving the reading public and the American public of context that allows them to make more informed choices about what they believe is happening rather than relying upon the press to tell them?
Yes. Yes. That's the easy and complicated answer. One of the other things that we are also dealing with is a push, at least in my publication and my chain, to shorter stories. Part of the issue with metrics is that people who are looking at the numbers are not necessarily journalists. And so there may be reasons that someone doesn't read to the bottom of a story that may have more to do with three screens of ads than it does with the interest in the story. But we are under the gun to write much shorter stories. At the Daily Report 3 or 4 years ago, I was writing routinely 2,000 word stories. Our audience liked the analysis, the context, that was part of what we provided. That's hard to do in 500 words, which is about 5 or 6 paragraphs.
Bill, some time ago, this was years ago, you wrote a story about the death penalty in Georgia. And my recollection is that you went in with kind of a sense of what you thought the facts were, but as you did more and more investigation, you saw something differently that you hadn't, you didn't know that you were going to find. But that, as I recall, that was a long story.
A year and a half.
And it was long, and I think it was
yes.
Published in more than one additional paper.
Correct. Right. Four.
Four. Is one of the issues today that the public's appetite for long, thorough, factually packed pieces is different than it was back then?
I think attention spans are probably shorter because of, you know, also because of people get a lot of their news off their phone, right? So I don't know how many people read long stories on their phone. I can do it, you know, if it's a good story. I think if the stories are well written and interesting, yeah, people stay with them. Some of the best stories I've ever read are long, you know, really in-depth long stories.
I don't think you're the typical consumer.
I do think that, I mean, you know, the Atlanta Constitution has a breaking news department and an investigative news department, and it serves both those functions, and I think it serves, I mean, I guess there's going to be, the very next panel is going to be about how well it serves that investigative function. So clearly the appetite is there. There's a lot of, I mean, one of the nice things about the, you know, the internet age is there's a lot of long-form journalism online, you know. It exists alongside the sort of, you know, the daily grind that I, you know, after, you know, however many years, still, you know, get a rush out. You know, you file stories, and then you file the next story, and then you file the next story, and it's, I mean, both things can coexist, and both can do their job well.
Mark, if you or your organization ever looked at the demographics of the people that read your stuff, would you know what that is?
I'm not sure about that. I mean, we get all kinds of reports based on what papers put our stories on the front page and things like that. I've not seen more than that in terms of actually, you know, I don't know when you say demographics, age.
I mean, and age and education.
Yeah, I'm not aware of that.
Okay. Do either of you get that information from your publications?
Just try to do my job. Don't want to worry about that.
They haven't started providing me with demographics yet.
But from that comment, I understand they do give you a lot of information about your stories.
We're getting numbers, as I said. We're getting metrics. I think part of what the news business is also trying to figure out, and part of it is what advertising is trying to figure out, is which metrics, which numbers are really the best to follow. Do you want to follow the number of page views? Do you want to follow the number of clicks? Part of the problem is that some of the biggest clicks are, you know, kitten photos, truly. Things that we call listicles, which are, you know, BuzzFeed's 10 favorite whatever. Those actually get huge numbers of clicks. And if we paid attention only to that, we'd be running kitten photos instead of legal stories, truly. So, you know, there's also, as Mark said, how long readers spend with the story, and the conflict is, you know, if you only spend 29 seconds on a story, and I get those measurements, is that because our legal community reads really fast and can go through five graphs in 30 seconds, or is it because they're bored with the story? We don't know that answer, we just know the number. That's the problem.
Could each of you tell me something that you're working on, why you selected it, and why do you think an audience is going to like it?
It's one story I'm working on rather than I talk about.
You forget, we're in competition.
Which you did write.
So, one a few years ago, I did a story about Justice Kennedy. How did this guy, who was raised Catholic in California, born in the 1930s, how did this guy become the court's champion of gay rights? And there had been a lot of talk that he had a mentor out in California, and it turned out that he did, who was a closeted gay man. So I went out and reported a story on that. I mean, I thought that was a fascinating story and would be well received because, you know, it actually gets behind the, you know, gets behind the court's opinions. It's like, what is it that's motivating this man? I mean, yeah, sure, his view of the law and all that, but you know, there's more to it than that, and so that's one example.
That's fascinating because that. As I take it from your description of that article, is that people, you thought, at least you did, and thought that readers would have a greater understanding of how he decided and why he had become the swing vote in those kinds of cases, because here was a fact that he had that was important that you thought might in fact impact his decision.
I thought it might well have an influence on his decision making.
And was that, did you write that before or after he left the court?
Oh no, before. I wrote it when the court had decided to take up the eventually became the, you know, landmark gay marriage decision, but before the decision was issued.
There was a recent event, a news report about David Wright, who is an ABC correspondent, who was interested in on what he thought was a conversation that he was having. And I'm not sure exactly who he thought he was having it with, but it ended up being taped by this organization called Veritas. But he is a reporter for World News Tonight on Good Morning America and Nightline. And here are four of the comments that he made. I don't think we're terribly interested in voters. He was talking about covering elections. The commercial imperative is incomparable with the news, meaning that the demand of news as a business takes precedent over the news itself. And then talking about one of the presidential candidates said, I myself am a socialist. I favor national health care and narrowing the wealth gap. Now, that gives you a perspective on his how you might, through what lens you might view his reporting. Just like knowing something about Justice Kennedy might give you a perspective on how he was deciding cases. But we don't often get this inside look into journalism and journalists' backgrounds and philosophies that we get from almost anybody else upon who there's reporting. Why is that?
Well, you don't have people secretly tape recorded very often. I guess.
Well, before you say that, that was his response, is that I was, didn't know I was talking to this person, never said that that's, I didn't mean all that, I didn't believe all those things. My question is, does it help a reader have an understanding, just like Justice Kennedy, understand the writing of a journalist if they know a background about that journalist?
I guess I would ask this. There's a real debate over whether or not journalists should identify which president appointed judges. And I know a lot of judges are not happy about that because they feel that who appointed them doesn't dictate how they rule. I think that's the same thing with journalists. You know, we all have our personal opinions about things, but like judges, those of us who have been in the business for a long time and, you know, we strive to do the same thing, to present things in as neutral a manner as possible. And I would equate that with judges. So if you as a judge, I mean, I'd be interested in what you think. Do you think that judges should not, that we should not identify who appointed judges?
Well, it wasn't really your turn to ask your one question.
That wasn't my one question.
Well, here's my experience with that. And 10 years ago, it was seldom that any report on a case, even if it was a controversial case and an opinion that I issued, was there any comment about who appointed me. I would say on the sensitive issues that I decided in the last 2 years of my tenure, there are two things that happened. One, they always noted who appointed me. And then they would show what other judges ruled the same way I had, and there were two of us in the country. And then they compared it with other judges that had decided in a different way. And they listed those judges. And then they would comment how in a Republican judge in a list of other Democratic judges somehow reached a right opinion as opposed to these other judges whose reasoning was more heavily criticized. Now, you can't tell me that reporting wasn't intentional to try to say that that who appointed me somehow reflected my unobjectivity in reaching a decision.
Well, I would just say I've covered federal courts now for a long time, 25 or so years. In big cases, I always try to say who appointed the judges who made the decision, and there's really one reason why. Because if I don't, I'm going to get email after email after email asking me who appointed.
From readers.
Well, so I think people want to know, and I think it tells more of the story.
I think the one difference I would say between when I got hired at the AJC and when President Trump appointed Brett Kavanaugh is no one hired me at the AJC for wanting to know what my background was in terms of my politics. They wanted to know what my experience was in terms of journalism. But you can't deny the fact that increasingly, there may not be Obama judges and there may not be Trump judges, as John Roberts said a couple years ago, But certainly, there is a difference between the judges that Obama nominated and Trump nominated, and very intentionally so. So you're depriving readers, I think, of a little bit of context when you don't say that on the Supreme Court, where there are five Republican appointees who all seem to vote the same way on a case, and four Democratic appointees who all seem to vote the same way, you're depriving the public of valuable contextual information.
And when they go the other way, it makes it even more interesting.
Right. I mean, the selection of judges is a political process. Why would we...
Yes, I know.
Right, you've gone through it. So why would we leave that information out? That's another question. Sorry.
But that context is valuable. We just don't get any context about you.
Well, I mean, I mean, you're making decisions that, you know, actually, you know, affect in some cases whether people can walk the streets or not. I don't have that power. I don't have life tenure. I mean, I think there are real differences between our roles and our jobs that might at least explain in part why there would be a different level of focus on the backgrounds and experiences of the people filling.
My friend Richard Griffiths talks about the absolute importance in a democracy of a free press, and I believe that. But the value of the press's influence within a democracy, I think, is that people who get information from the press ought to be able to know whether or not there is any implied or overt bias in the report. So I would disagree with you that what I do, which is very visible, you can see everything that I did. I can't see, and I don't know how I ever could see, what it is that might influence you and the cultures within your newsrooms unless there is more transparency.
How do you propose to do that? I mean, what's the mechanism that you would propose for... I mean, our bios, to a large extent, are out there on the internet. So what is it that you are looking for in terms of implied bias?
I have every single job I've had lately. Everybody says that every job I have and every job that other people in the same position as me have is that we all have implied bias. In fact, the Justice Department had this great initiative about looking into and educating people about implied bias, and they say everybody has it. Is there implied bias in journalism?
Do you believe in implied bias in what the Justice Department is saying?
That's your fourth question.
Okay. That's my job.
Is there implied bias in journalism and in newsrooms?
Truthfully, I think that's part of what we struggle with what I call, where journalism has become more fungible, where we are struggling with who are really journalists, who have background and training, who's writing on the internet, what, you know, if they are putting themselves forth as journalists, what does that mean? I think we are struggling with that. And, you know, there are people who may be putting information out on the internet with the claim that they are journalists, that I would not consider them necessarily to be journalists. I would consider them to be people who are putting their own opinions out and masquerading as neutral fact finders. So there is that issue. I think, again, to go back to it, I think those of us who have been in the profession a long time, my colleagues here, we struggle to do the same thing that judges like you on the bench do, which is, regardless of, we all bring our own backgrounds and experiences and opinions to it, but we really work hard to make sure that we do not let those influences affect our reporting. Are we perfect? No. But I think it's comparable to what judges attempt to do as well.
Mark, what do you think of that? Then I'm going to read you something.
It's to say something
I wrote. Not anything you wrote.
Well, I mean, I mean, I go back to what I said earlier. You struggle, every time you write a story, you struggle to present what you think is a fair story. I mean, you know, it, on the most basic level is you make a story, you write a story that includes an allegation by someone against someone else. Are you getting the other side to respond? I mean, that's journalism 101, obviously. But I mean, it's basic fairness. Do we try to write stories that are basically fair? Of course we do, and we don't always succeed. I'll be the first to admit that there are stories that run, and you look back and you say, I wish I had not used that adjective. I wish I had put that paragraph at the very bottom of the story, you know, much higher, so that there was more context. I mean, we strive, I think, I mean, I'm not saying anything, you know, very outlandish. We strive to, all of us, to write stories that you stand behind because you feel like you've tried to give all sides of the story a fair shake, knowing that you don't always get there.
When I was in the Whitewater investigations, Sue Schmidt covered us from the Washington Post, and Sue had written an article about the investigation. Specifically, had was asking me about my thought about the change of independent counsels from Robert Fisk to Ken Storm, and she inserted two specific lines about something I had said that was not correct. And so when she was in the office, I said, "Sue, can I talk to you about your article?" I said, why is it that you place those lines where you place them in the article? Because it leads to this logical conclusion for the reader. And she said, well, that's why I put them in. And I said, well, they had to do with a factual reason. And the factual question you had for me is, why did I make a decision? But you ended up saying that I made the decision based upon what you thought I felt based upon these two comments. And she said, well, if I was wrong about that, I apologize. And then I said, why did you do that? And she said, well, let me tell you. With the advent of CNN, we've had the liberty where you didn't have all this real-time coverage. We'd had the liberty of being pretty deliberative about our writing. That has changed. And we have made a decision at the Post that the value of print, because it's always going to come out later, this was before they had a digital platform, that we have to add value, and that value is our interpretation of the facts. Do you think journalists today, like you, Mark, and you, Bill, and Robin, that you take facts and interpret them for your readers?
I'm not sure what interpret means. I do know that, for example, in terms of striving for fairness and allowing, you know, as Mark said, calling all sides, getting commentary, I have slightly higher standard than that, which is if somebody gives me a statement, for example, characterizes a judge's ruling that I know is absolutely inaccurate, I'm not going to let it stand alone. What I will do and have done is told the lawyers, I'm not going to run this like this because this is not what the opinion said. I know it's what you and your clients want me to say. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to, you know, if you insist I use that statement, the next paragraph is going to make it very clear that what you said wasn't true. I'm going to give you an opportunity to rethink what you want to say. Some lawyers rethink it. I've had other lawyers who've come back and said, nope, that's what my client wants to say. And, okay, fine, the next graph is going to put the lie to that. So, it, you know, is that an interpretation of the facts? I think interpretation, we get into this loosey-goosey, everybody has their own set of facts. I think what we strive to do as journalists is try to get to what we believe to be accurate. You know, I think if you're interpreting the facts, it suggests that everybody gets their own set of facts, and I don't think that's
accurate. Let me drill down then. Separate and apart from opinions issued by courts, because they are self-contained, and all you get is what the opinion is that's issued by a court. But trials are different. What happens in the morning of a trial that might seem to be incredibly effective could be completely undone in the afternoon of the trial, because you have other facts that counter, that will show that what you heard in the morning probably isn't true. How do you make sure that when you're covering a trial, and you both generally tend to cover important trials, to make sure that you understand fully what has gone on in the courtroom before you report?
Well, you got to be there. I mean, I think it's hard to cover a trial from beginning to end. If the trial's big enough, we'll definitely be there, even during jury selection, which I think is as fascinating as some of the trial itself. But you know, you talked about cameras in the courtroom. The good thing about not having cameras in federal court is that TV people leave during the day because there's no footage, so I get to sit there and get all the testimony. They don't always leave, but
yes, 4 o'clock. Yes,
they got to go outside. But you can't always be there. But I think it's very important if you're going to cover a trial. If you cover the state's case and you're not there for the defense, I mean that's not good. You know, you try to get if you can't do it, try to get somebody else to be there. But you just got to be there.
Cover the cross. I mean, I've seen reporters who have covered direct and left. You got to cover the cross. Now, you know, if there is no cross, then I don't think a defense attorney could come up to me later and say, boy, your story was biased in favor of the prosecution, if there was no cross. But I think, yes, Bill is right. We absolutely have an obligation to cover both sides.
So, Bill, you say that your practice is to, trials.
I love
you're covering
trials.
Being there the whole time to make sure you understand all the dynamics.
I tell you, it's really hard though. You stay in a courtroom all day and you hear all this interesting testimony, and then you get back and you only have a story that can be about that long.
Yeah.
Oh, that's hard. It's frustrating. So it's what you have to leave out that's painful sometimes. But you try to get the gist of what happened.
There's a personnel issue too. I mean, quite frankly, the Daily Report is down to 4 reporters. They cut me loose to cover the entire Tex MacGyver trial. And I was filing 3 times a day. Was everybody reading it? Yeah, but is that highly unusual? It is. I mean, years ago when I was first doing court reporting in Alabama, could I sit through every trial all day and work the hallways? Yeah. Is that the best way to do it? Yes. Could I write as long and as much as I wanted? Yes. None of that applies today.
So you covered Tex MacGyver only because it was a lawyer who was on the defendant in the case?
Yeah, that was a large part of it.
Okay, we have 10 minutes. I promised you each one question. Robin's used up all your questions, so.
Well, I was going to ask you, so you're 14 years on the bench, right?
Yes.
14 years. What was the most difficult decision you had to make? It could be sentencing, it could be a summary judgment motion, it could be an evidentiary decision.
Here was the most difficult personal decision I had to make. I mean, there are a lot of hard decisions, a lot of hard sentencing decisions, but as far as something that required me to do a lot of introspection and to try to make sure that I had that I was not being influenced by the content was this case. There's a pro se litigant that had filed a lawsuit based upon a complaint that had been filed in Utah, who was on supervised release because of a sex offense violation, and objected to a requirement by the state of Georgia that he have to disclose to the probation office his internet usage, and specifically his usernames and passwords. Because he was a sex offender, the state knew that most sex offenses were somehow touched the internet. That's how a lot of young women were and girls were recruited. And they wanted to make sure that that wasn't happening, and they wanted an accountability process for that, so they passed the statute as part of the requirements of some of the under supervised release. What I knew was, and he came in and he said, I blog. Blogging is important to me, and I have a First Amendment right to blog anonymously. And by disclosing my username and password, the state officials could find out what I was blogging about. And what he was blogging about was men having relationships with young boys and encouraging those. That he thought that that was a justifiable and worthwhile worthwhile conduct between older men and young boys. And I spent hours looking at all the First Amendment cases to see whether or not it was the law was such as he made it out to be. And yet what I knew, because I had access to some of his blog material, was absolutely filth and outrageous, and thought that that should not be published on the internet. But my job was to decide whether or not he had a right under the First Amendment to anonymously blog, and I concluded that he did. But it took a lot to separate out my feelings about what he was and would continue to blog about if, in fact, I struck down the state requirement for him to give username and password, which I did.
That would have been a good story.
You know, got a single media outlet in the city covering.
Yeah. Pro se litigants.
Well, not because I ended up appointing a lawyer to represent him, because I thought his position was really credible. Mark?
So I wanted to ask you something in the context of the Me Too movement.
Yep.
We've had, in recent weeks, there was a federal judge in Kansas who resigned over sexual improprieties. There was testimony from a former clerk of Judge Reinhardt in the Ninth Circuit about sexual harassment. Of course, Judge Kaczynski, also the Ninth Circuit. There seems the courts have sort of responded slowly, the federal judiciary, to this issue. And there's talk now of actually beefing up the office that was created. So I want to ask you, in your time as a federal judge, without obviously names, whether you witnessed any conduct on the part of colleagues in the federal judiciary that you thought, or maybe now looking back, you thought, that really crossed the line, I should have said something, or maybe you did say something.
There was one instance, it actually was not a judge in this district, but because the judge had helped us some in our district, and I had tried a case in that district, that I became suspicious of his conduct as it related to a particular woman, where he had a supervisory responsibility over her. And I did report that. My regret about that is that my feelings about the judiciary, as far as that, and so I'm big on culture, and I think you should be big on culture, but there's a culture in the judiciary about everybody being siloed, and everybody gets to do and be responsible. This is judges. We're all siloed, we all have our own cases. There are some colleagues where you can actually talk about a legal issue with and get an honest response and input about it. There are others that say, you've got to do what you think is right, and it doesn't really help you through the vetting process. The same happens at all levels about all issues, that there is this segregation between chambers and judges where it is really, really difficult to confront somebody about any issue, because the cultural is so strongly against them. And so I understand why in the past there has not been a willingness or a mechanism to really, where that was going on, to really disclose those and have people look at it. Frankly, I think that, that if in fact you can engage the process and get beyond, and if your colleagues that you're reporting these things to would could go beyond that inertia against doing something, that the processes that we have in place are will work, but I think there's a flaw in the processes.
So you get number five?
Raise your hand if you think we're off.
I don't think you answered her earlier. But
actually, my question really is along the lines of Mark's question, but broader. And you've addressed some of it. But my question is, have you ever been made aware of or confronted by unethical behavior by a judge or a lawyer? And what action, if any, did you take?
Once that I could, sitting here, once that I can recall, that I'm not sure it's unethical, but it was certainly improper. And I did report that to the chief judge and reported it to others of my colleagues. And while correcting that was very, very difficult to do because we are siloed, it was ultimately correct. But it should not have gone on as long as it had before.
Can you elaborate? Or is that like, no more questions, Robin?
Elaborate.
On the nature of the behavior without necessarily naming an individual, but.
I'd just say generally it had to do with staffing assignments within the chain. It had to do with the way the work was being managed and performed, and nothing of a sexual nature. So, are we still friends?
Yes.
Well, this was an interesting experience, I hope, for us, but I hope it was for you. We tried to touch upon some things that you might not have had a chance to hear from journalists before. We do have people doing different functions. I think we know that their job is hard, their resources are limited, their time is short as far as the amount of time that they would like to have but that they don't have. But I think that's the world that we're in, and I predict to you that it's not going to get any better. But I do have one last question. Today, knowing what you know about your job, would you become a journalist?
I mean, the son of a journalist? You worked in the paper for 25 years? Absolutely. It's been the time of my life.
Mark?
Yeah, I really like what I do.
I'm not sure I would. I'm not sure I would, given what we are dealing with these days.
Thank you. Let's give the...
Thank you very much. We're going to bring the next panel up and hopefully get started in the next few minutes.
We will still have lunch. I heard it was like
that. Yeah.
Oh, you're welcome.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, and he did? Oh, did
you? You should know that since he was U.S. attorney and I've covered him, he has had no reflection about calling me on the phone and letting me know exactly what he thought about what I read.
Yes. I'm a college university graduate.
Are you really?
Yes.
Yes. How long have you been here?
Yes, yes. It's been a long time. Wow.
Thanks for saying that.
I just
want
to say,
I am my child.
my colleague Jim Salvers has been involved in for years.
We basically nationalize right now media.
No, that's a long story, but I
who is this? Who's part right now?
Yeah.